ransom for my life. Oh, he is my song. So you are good, you're good.
You are for me, not against me.
I am.
Good morning. So I'm gonna get prepared here real quick. Brother Steve talked about how we met Wednesday to go over this sermon, and he used a nice word, compact. What that really means is it's a lot of information. So if y'all will just bear with me, we'll get through this together. Can we do a round of applause for the youth real quick, for Adrian and all them? They do a great job. So quick question. How many here have ever tried to share the gospel, but were maybe too scared or too nervous? I'll raise my hand. I was too. Well, in today's message, my plan is to teach you why we don't share, what God says about sharing, why it's important we share, and then eventually how to share. So we'll be in Romans 10, verses 14 and 15 today, and while you guys turn there, I'm going to tell you a quick story. So when I moved here from Rockwood, Rockwood's a very small place, roughly 5,000 people. That had nothing to do with me being shy, not wanting to talk to people. That was just me. But I moved here, and I got put into an apartment with four different guys. And it wasn't like some like gross room, like apartment. We each had our own, you know, bedroom and bathroom. We shared a living room and a kitchen. And I didn't know how to talk to them. So I implemented a system, and this system was foolproof, honestly. I got a packet of those Kool-Aid water flavoring things, and I set them on the counter in the kitchen. And each time I'd hear somebody come in, I'd go into the kitchen, grab one of those Kool-Aid packets. And if they looked like they wanted to talk, or if they looked like they weren't busy, I'd sit down and talk with them. And then I'd just keep that packet and I'd put it up. But if they looked busy, or like they didn't like have the time to talk, I'd just go in my room and throw it away. And so this is so I could talk to them. And so it's crazy how the Lord works in your life to a point to where I can go from being that shy to a point where I'm up here able to speak to everybody. We'll be in Romans chapter 10, verses 14 and 15 again. And it says, "How then can they call on him they have not believed in? And how can they believe without hearing about him? And how can they hear without a preacher? And how can they preach unless they are sent? As it is written, how beautiful are the feet of those who bring good news." Bow our heads and pray. All right. Dear Heavenly Father, I'm just so thankful for this opportunity, Lord. Lord, I pray for your guidance through this message. I pray that the people here today that may not know Christ or may know somebody that just doesn't know Christ, that they get the courage to be able to share with them. And from this message, they may learn how. Lord, we are so thankful for your love and your mercy, and we're even more thankful about your son's sacrifice on the cross. Lord, we love you and we praise you, and it's in your great name that we pray. Amen. All right. So I'm going to start off with a passage breakdown of this. What this passage represents is it represents what it takes for somebody to come to the point of calling upon Christ. Paul tells us the exact steps oppositely. So he starts out by telling us in the first question, how can anyone call on Christ if they do not believe in him? What Paul insists here, as he does many times throughout his letters, is that it is belief in Christ that initiates salvation. But then he moves on to the next question that says, how can anyone believe in Christ if they have never heard of him or if they don't know who he is? So what he's telling there is that someone just can't magically believe in Christ. They have to first hear about him. And so it's important that we want to share and that a preacher is needed. So the third question of the passage, of verse 14, is how can anyone hear about Christ unless someone preaches to them? So Paul tells us that preaching is essential. And I don't necessarily take that to mean just preaching like Brother Steve does every Sunday, but I take that as anything of proclaiming God's word to somebody. Preaching as in teaching others about the good news that we have received. And so the final question of verse 14 is, how can anyone hear about Christ? I repeated that one, sorry. he starts verse 15 with the final question of the passage, and that is, how will anyone preach to the gospel of Jesus if they aren't sent? So what that tells us is the first step of sharing the gospel is not preaching, but being sent somewhere to preach. So that rises a question, who does the sending? Well, in the case of Paul and the other apostles, it was Jesus that sent them. But for us, we have a lot more opportunities. For us, churches do sending. They do mission trips. There's organizations that are specifically for sending people to share the gospel. And if you're wealthy enough and have the funds, you can send yourself. But something that's often overlooked is that you can send yourself to your community. You do not have to travel somewhere else to share the gospel with others. Cookeville is in need of the gospel just as much as anywhere else is. And so, in the last verse, or the last sentence of verse 15, Paul quotes Isaiah 52, 7. And he says, "How beautiful are the feet of those who preach the good news." So what Paul is saying there is he's telling us that anyone who shares the good news of God has beautiful feet, or if you prefer, blessed feet, because they are using their feet to benefit God. They are using their feet to share the good news, to advance God's kingdom. So when you turn this passage around, you get the process in which he's referencing. You get that first, a person is sent. And then, from being sent, that person can preach the good news of the Lord. And then through preaching, a person might believe. And finally, if that person believes, then they have the opportunity to call upon Christ. So that moves us into the first question of this passage. What is the good news? Well, to start, and I was kind of hoping Timothy would be here because he could correct me in my way of pronouncing Greek, so I hope I don't butcher this. The Greek word used originally was euangelion, and it directly translates into the good news or good message. But this wasn't used initially in biblical sense. This was used just in worldly sense, as in, for example, if your city was at war, a messenger would come back, and they would tell you the good news was that your city was winning, or the good news was that your brother or father had survived the war and would be returning. What New Testament writers used this word for was the use of the good news of salvation, the liberation from sin and brokenness. And so now we know that the good news, or the gospel, is referencing to Jesus' life, death, and resurrection for our sins. And so as taught by Paul, the good news is no longer just a statement. It's not something that we just say. It's something that we need to proclaim and need to tell to others. So this leads into the second question of the passage. Why is it important to share the gospel? Well, for one, as followers of Christ, our job is to share the gospel. But there are many people walking around in our communities, elsewhere, anywhere, that don't know Christ. They're lost. And I don't know how or when any of you came to Christ, but if you understand the darkness, the scared, the not knowing what tomorrow is going to be like, then you understand the urgency and the importance of sharing the gospel with those people in your community. And so I think back to a couple years ago, before I started to pursue Christ. You've heard my testimony. And so about 3 years ago, I was lost. I was in darkness. I was scared because I didn't know what would happen if I were to die the next day. That's a scary thing. So those people that are walking around in our community that don't know Christ are experiencing that same exact lost, that exact same scared, and that exact same darkness. And the problem is some of them might even not know, they might not know that a light exists. And that's terrifying that we've done such a poor job that they might not even know that Jesus is there for them. They might not know that they can be led out of that darkness that they're experiencing. And so that's one reason we need to share. Because through telling them about Jesus, we provide them with that light needed to be able to guide them out of the darkness. So there's a major question that arises from this. What is stopping you? Okay, I'm going to do another show of hands. How many people here have ever shared the gospel? And that's okay if you haven't, as long as you plan to. But I was just wanting a number. Well, I can tell you there are three main reasons to me why people don't. The first reason is maybe you're too scared or nervous. That was my case. Well, if that's the same reason for you, let me refer you to a verse that has meant a lot to me this past year. And it's Isaiah 41:10, and it says, "Do not fear, for I am with you. Do not be afraid, for I am your God. I will strengthen you. I will help you. I will hold on to you with my righteous right hand." Sharing the gospel is a scary thing. It's scary to go out in public and talk to people about something you believe. It really is. But from this passage, you know that the Lord has your back at all times. He's not going to put you into a situation that you can't handle. You may mess up. That's just your fault. But you'll grow from each instance that you mess up. So when sharing, you will mess up a couple times. That's a definite. But from each time you mess up, you grow a little bit more and to a point where you can eventually share fluently. Like it's easy for you to do. And so we're not expected to always get it right, but we are expected to at least try. So the second reason somebody might not share is maybe They think they lack the biblical knowledge to be able to talk to somebody. A lot of people don't share because they're scared they're going to be asked those tough questions, right? Well, I'm telling you now, if you studied apologetics all day, there's still going to be questions you don't know. Sometimes I don't know is the best answer you can give somebody, because you do not want to make up some answer and feed them a lie and say they come to Christ with that lie. That would be awful. They didn't have genuine acceptance because their foundation of their faith started on a lie. Well, if that's the case for you, maybe you think you lack that biblical knowledge, I got another passage for you. It's Matthew 28:19. And it says, "Go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit." So we're called to make disciples. And to do that, sharing the gospel is essential. And so what that passage doesn't say, and this is important because I had to tell myself this, what it does not say is it does not say study the whole Bible, know all of church history, and then make disciples. God doesn't expect us to know everything. He just expects us to know enough to be able to share the love that we have received. And so the third reason people don't share is maybe they don't know. Maybe they've never been taught how to share their faith, or maybe they're new to faith and they don't know how. So my plan is to do that today. But before we get into that, you need to know the current problems that we face in evangelism today. The first problem is there's a lack of God in society. We all know that. Evangelism today is a lot harder than it was in the 90s. That's not too long ago. That's just 22 years ago. And I don't know this from personal experience because, you know, I got the last end of the 90s. But from talking to Brother Steve and other pastors, when you would share the gospel in the 90s, it was easier because when talking to someone about God, they had a basic understanding of his character. They knew a little bit of who he was. The problem there then that you had to fix was everyone thought that you were going to heaven off your good works. That's easy to fix. You just tell them they're wrong. But why it's harder today is nobody knows which God you're talking about. Society is so saturated with gods, lowercase g, that they might not know which one you're referring to when sharing the gospel with them. So that means that there's a lot of pre-evangelism needed before sharing the gospel. You have to start in Genesis and work your way to Acts. And if you can, work your way all the way to Revelation. You have to tell them the whole story. And the reason for that is because if they don't understand that Christ loved them or why Christ loves them, then they won't understand why it means anything to them. And so once they learn, they have a full understanding of the message and they fully understand why Christ's love is needed and why they need to accept him, that they are lost of sin. And so the second problem, and this is probably the worst problem, is everyone wants to reap and no one wants to sow. And so when sharing the gospel, there's two factors. There's sowing, which is referred to as planting the seed, or in gospel sense, it's sharing the gospel with others. And there's reaping, and that's collecting the crop which has been grown, or we refer to as witnessing someone come to Christ. And so the problem here is that everyone wants to reap. Everyone wants to witness somebody come to Christ, and no one wants to put in the hard work prior. Well, there is no reaping without sowing. So to give you an example of how devastating this is people think, oh, well, this person doesn't, I'll wait until they're close to accepting Christ and I'll share with them and get to witness that thing. Well, imagine someone needs to hear the gospel 20 times. Just 20, that's not many. 20 times before considering accepting Christ. But they stop hearing the gospel at 10 because that person thinks, oh, someone else will do it. And then I can swoop in at the end. And then I get to reap. That would be eternally devastating to that person because of selfishness, because of pride. And so, as mentioned before, sowing is needed. So sowing should be the first factor we want to pursue, and it should be what we want to do. And if you have the opportunity to reap, take that as a blessing from the Lord. The third problem, as mentioned in the last problem, is I'll just say everyone thinks someone else will do it. Everyone thinks, well, if I don't do it, someone else will. Well, I can tell you, everyone is as lazy as the person that says that. They're not going to share. If you don't have to, you're not going to. So they decide not to share because maybe someone else will. But let me tell you, there's another lazy thing that Christians do. It's not always a bad thing, because there's a part of it that's good, but something lazy that we do is invite people to church to avoid sharing the gospel with them. That's bad. It's good you took the initiative to invite somebody to the church, but you should finish the job. The mentality there is, if I invite them to church, they'll learn about Jesus there. Well, that may not always be the case. Maybe they don't listen during the sermon. What then? It should not be put, the burden of sharing the gospel should not be put on your church. As Christians, we are to go out in our community and do that for the church so more people will fill in. So don't put that burden on your church. Take it upon yourself to want to share the gospel with friends. And if you invite them to church, make sure you share the gospel. They know who Jesus is before they walk in those doors. The fourth problem, and this is a big problem, you can't assume someone has salvation. There are a lot of Christians that I've met that don't truly have salvation. There's a lot of Christians that think their good works is what's going to come in. There are a lot of Christians that call themselves that so they can avoid calling themselves atheists. And so there might be people here today that's like. There may be people here today that come to church every Sunday but have never truly accepted Christ. And I'm not trying to call you out if you have, and if that's you. But if you have any doubt in your mind that you haven't truly accepted Christ, I'd rather you come to me and Brother Steve and ask us about it than to walk around not knowing. I would rather you leave this building today knowing for sure that you have salvation than to walk around doubting. Amen. And so now on the fifth and last problem. And it is, do not change your message to make somebody feel good. If you think a part of the gospel is offensive, then you're not a Christian. I can tell you that. There's a lot of times these progressive pastors or just misled people in general that leave out certain sin or certain parts of the message so that people will be more willing to listen to it, so people will be more willing to fill into their church. Well, I can tell you right now that anybody that was preaching that message or was supposed to have accepted Christ through that message is going to hell. And that's sad. Just because this person that preached it to them is giving them false information. If you look at Galatians 1, verses 8 through 10, it says, "But if we or an angel from heaven should preach to you a gospel contrary to what we have preached to you, a curse be on him. As we have said before, I now say again, if anyone is preaching to you a gospel contrary to what you received, a curse be on him. For am I now trying to persuade people or God? Or am I striving to please people? If I were still trying to please people, I would not be a servant of Christ." What Paul is saying here is that it doesn't matter who is sharing the gospel. It could be an angel from heaven. If they share a gospel presentation contrary to the one that they received from Christ, that a curse should be upon them. And then he moves on to ask us if we're trying to please people or God. That's something else we find ourselves doing quite often. Us as Christians constantly pursuing a person over God, a thing over God. You might look to a relationship and think, I'm wanting to pursue this person, and then God gets the back burner. You might look at a celebrity or a famous football player or a famous anything and think, I like this person. I'm going to follow them. I'm going to commit my life to watching them. And then you put God to the back burner. Or there's events. There's a lot of events that people do or activities that push them away from God. So I can tell you right now that if there's ever a situation where you're putting anything over God, it doesn't matter who it is or what it is, you're wrong. There's never a situation where putting anything over God is the correct thing to do. So now that we've discussed the major problems of evangelism today, I will now teach you how to share. But before we get into that, I really, like, real quick, just want to show you an example of how bad your first attempt can go. No, I'm kidding. I do want to tell you about the first time I shared. So I was in KC, which is it's through the BCM. It's a small group for college-age men. And we get together and we just go through the Bible together. It's a great time. It's grown me a lot. Well, my roommate who's here today was the leader of the KC at the time. And I was hiding in the back, you know, trying not to share. I was trying to avoid getting called on. And Dave noticed I was hiding. And he goes, "Hey, Alex, how about you share the gospel with us today?" And I knew what it was. I just wasn't ready to share. That's what I kept saying. That was my excuse to push it off. And so I used the way that I knew most, which was the hand motion. And so I started here. And I got to the point in between where it was like the sacrificing of animals for atonement and then the sacrificing of Jesus, and noticed my hand never stopped moving. So I was talking and talking, and I looked down, and I was like, what is my hand doing? How many of you know the song Up Down by Morgan Wallen? That's a reference to what my first time sharing the gospel was like. And if you don't know what that song is, he basically says up, down a bunch of times. My friend Matthew Hembry will constantly just make fun of me for that. He'll bring that up and he'll pick at me all the time. He'll say, you remember that first time you shared? And it's pretty bad. So now that you know an example of what it can be like and how bad it can be, you'll know it's okay. I recovered from it and I do well now. But when sharing, there are certain things you got to make sure you do. The first thing you got to do is love that person like Christ loves you. The second thing you got to do is have patience with that person, because although they differ in opinion, maybe their opinion is silly. Maybe you think they believe something silly. You still have to be patient with them because they are still a creation of God. They are still made in His image. And then the last thing you need to do is, after sharing, pray with that person, because prayer is the most powerful spiritual tool that we all have. It's not used enough. And so when sharing, if you pray with that person, you're leaving them with that final seek of, like, just the approval from God. You're showing them that God cares for them, that you care for them enough that you want to talk to God for them on their behalf. There are also certain points that need to be made. The first point that needs to be made is that we have a sinful nature. That person needs to know that they are sinful, and without Jesus, they're going to be eternally separated from Him. The second thing they need to know is that God loves them and loved them so much that He sent His Son to die on the cross for them. They need to know that they are loved, and that love extended to a point of Jesus Christ putting Himself on the cross for our sins. The third thing they need to know is that Jesus lived a perfect life. This is something that's often skipped in gospel presentations. They need to know that Jesus was tempted for sin in every single way that we were tempted. How crazy is that? But He still remained pure. I mean, we can't do that, but He did. And then they need to know of Jesus' death. They need to know that He truly did die and remain that way for 3 days. The fifth point is Jesus' resurrection. They need to know that after those 3 days of being dead, that Jesus resurrected. And the reason that this point is important, I think it's the most important point of Jesus' life, is because when He resurrected, it told us that He was God. It told us that He had defeated sin and that He had defeated death, and that nothing could bind Him, nothing could hold Him down. And so then you need to bring up the ascension, that He goes back up to reign with the Father. But the last part, and this is important to the person you're sharing with, you need to tell them that through acceptance and repentance, acceptance of Jesus and repentance of sin, that they can have salvation and that they can one day reign with the Father in heaven. So now we'll go on to the first way to share. I think this way is the easiest way. So the first way is just tell them your testimony. Tell them how and when you came to Christ. But something you got to include, something that has to be included, is what Christ is currently doing in your life. That person needs to know that once they accept Christ, He does not stop working in your life, that He constantly wants to make you a better servant for Him. That's something that people leave out, is they'll share their testimony and they stop once they were saved. If I were a person and heard that kind of testimony, I'd think, oh, why would I accept Christ? He's going to stop pursuing me once I accept Him. So make sure to always include what He's doing in your life. The second way to share is the hand motion that I had told you guys before. And the youth know this method a little bit too well. I'm sure they're sick of seeing it by now. But the reason I like this method so much is it includes that pre-evangelism needed to get your gospel point across. It starts in Genesis and it ends in Acts. So I'm going to demonstrate that really quick up here. So it starts, in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. And on the earth, He made man. Well, we all know what happened. Man was deceived and ate of the fruit of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, and we fell. That introduced sin into the world. We were now separated from God. And so a blood atonement was needed to be made right with God, to no longer be separated. So what they did is they would sacrifice animals. And so they would sacrifice an animal, and they would sin. Sacrifice an animal, and they'd sin. And then they'd sacrifice another animal, they'd sin again. So there was no way of staying up. You would lose salvation all the time. And God seen this and knew it wasn't good, and He knew that He loved the world, so His plan was to send Jesus. And as I said before, Jesus lived that perfect life, and so God humbled Himself in the form of human and came down to our level. He put Himself in chaos for us. And so through His perfect life and eventual death and resurrection, and then He ascended into heaven, we learned that Jesus was God. And so when he ascended, he went back up into heaven. And so here's the part that you got to include, something the youth often forget. I got to remind them a couple times, is that it's acceptance that gets you here. They think as soon as Jesus ascended to heaven, we did too. That's not the case. So what you got to tell them is that they got to accept Jesus and then repent of their sins. And once they do that, they can be sure that they have salvation. And so that's the second way to share. The third way that I'm going to share with you today, and that's if you need a guided presentation with gospel, or not gospel, but like biblical, like scripture to back it up, is the Roman roads. And the Roman roads is one of the easiest ways to share, because if you memorize it, you got it down. You know the gospel like the back of your hand. And so that starts in Romans 3:23. It tells us that for all have sinned and fall short to the glory of God. What that tells us is that we are all sinners by nature and by choice. When Adam and Eve sinned, they introduced sin into the world. So when we were born into sin. But that also tells us that we are sinners by choice, because we wake up every day and choose to sin. The second verse is Romans 6:23. It says, "For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord." What that tells us is that we receive eternal life as a free gift because of God's love and mercy. What that tells us is that the payment that we should have received for our sin is death, but God loved us so much that he wanted us to live with him, and that he wanted to give us a way out. And that way out was through Jesus. Romans 5:8 says, "But God demonstrated his love towards us, and that while we were sinners, Christ died for us." What that tells us is we receive love and mercy despite our sinful nature. As said before, the wages, the payment that we should have received for our sin was death. But while we were sinning, while we were deserving of death, Christ died on the cross for us. If that's not love, I don't know what is. And so you move into the fourth passage, which is Romans 10, verses 9 through 10. And it says, "If you confess with your mouth Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. One believes with the heart, resulting in righteousness, and one confesses with the mouth, resulting in salvation." What that tells us is that we must trust and surrender our lives to Jesus for salvation. What that tells us is that through confessing with the heart and the mouth, that you can have assurance that you have salvation. And then the final verse of the Roman roads is Romans 10:13. And it says, "For everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved." What that tells us is through Jesus, through accepting Jesus, we can have assurance that we have salvation. So if you noticed, the last verse of the Roman roads is actually the verse right before the passage that we're in today, Romans 14 and 15. And the reason for that is it tells us exactly why you need to share. Because if you can get someone to the point of calling upon Christ, then they will have salvation. That's why we share. It's so not for us. We don't share for us. We don't matter in the equation. It's for God's kingdom and for his glory is why we share. So what I suggest is if you struggle or would like to know how, come up to me or Brother Steve. Find someone in the church that just ask us how to share the gospel. Do not feel embarrassed if you do not know. I would rather you know for sure and be able to share with others than to not know. But when going through the gospel, make sure to include these main points. You don't have to know everything. The Lord has your back, and it's not about you. Sharing the gospel is for those people that walk around that are experiencing darkness, that are lost, that may not know who Christ is. So make it your goal to share with somebody. If I could challenge you to one thing, share with one person this week. It could be a family member, it could be a coworker, it could be a fellow student that you go to school with. Share the gospel with somebody. You can only get better from it, so that's the only reason I think it'd be a good idea. All right, so again, I'm extremely grateful for this opportunity to be able to preach in front of y'all today. And would now like to close us out in prayer.